Y'all may have a seat. Oh, I love it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Wow. Can we give a hand to the worship team one more time? They did a good job in leading us. Man, I love that. When we hit the presence of God like that, it's like everything just fades away. Is that right? Everything just fades away and nothing else matters, only you and the Lord. And when you see that kingdom, when you see that king, you're willing to forsake all things. And what I'm praying for today is very simple, that all of us can get a revelation of his kingdom. That all of us here can get a revelation of his kingdom, because once you get a revelation of his kingdom, you will see something that you are willing to forsake everything for. That is a call that's not only worth living for, it is worth dying for. And many times, many of us here, we don't have a cause to even be willing to die for, and that's why we don't know how to live for something. And I'm believing that God's going to give you and show you something today if you're willing to be open. Tell God, God, I'm open. Amen? All right. And I'm continuing the series for this month. It's called Simple Faith. And I love this series, Simple Faith. This is the theme for our church for this year. I Beloved 2017, Simple Faith is what we're all about. Simple faith does not mean small faith. Simple faith does not mean small faith, but it is significant faith. Simple faith is significant faith. It is simply learning to wholly trust in God, cutting away the excess and focusing on the essentials. A lot of us here, we have picked up many excess stuff along our Christian walk, along our Christian faith, but we forget about the most substantial thing, about the essential things. We have a lot of accessories, but no substance. And what God wants to do is remove some of these accessories, things that don't really matter. Can you think just for a second, are there things in your life right now that don't actually really matter? You feel like they are because you like them. But actually, at the end of the day, they're taking your time. They're taking your focus. They're taking your attention. They're taking your energy. And they're even costing relationships in your life. They're excess thing. They're accessories. They don't really matter at the end of the day, but yet we are so focused on those things. But this year, we're about to downsize to upsize. We need to sometimes tear stuff down to build stuff up. Amen? We need to sometimes remove some things. We need to cut away some things in order for growth to happen in our life. Tell your neighbors, I think you need this. Now tell him, I think I need this more. Which one is easier to say? The second one. Oh man, I'm enjoying myself. The first week, we learn about simple faith in repentance. And we were checking out this guy named John the Baptist, right? And he was preaching the gospel of the kingdom. And he was the messenger of the king. He was calling out people into repentance. Repentance is not just about realizing that you're wrong. It's not the context of repentance there was not an individual repentance, but it is a kingdom-sized repentance. An individual repentance is simply this. Oh, I'm doing the wrong thing. Now I want to do the right thing. Because if you do that, here's what happened. Many people, have you ever tried to do that before? Make New Year's resolution, but never meet them? Like, I've committed to lose weight like 10 years ago. Ain't nothing ever happened. Now, the reason being, that's not true repentance. I remorse. I have a little guilt for feeling the way I feel, but it's not yet repentance, because repentance is not just about stopping and turning around, but walking away. Because if you don't walk away, the tendency is for you to moon back right to the stuff that you have been walking away from. That's not repentance. That's called moonwalking. We don't want to be doing that stuff, but John the Baptist calls it out to the Pharisees. You repent to the degree that you can handle it. You repent to the degree of your standard that you can compromise still. But God is calling for true repentance. And that's what we were talking about in the first week. If you haven't seen it, go check it out. It's on the website. Second week, Pastor Christian. Not only that, we were talking about the baptism of water and what that meant. That we actually literally means we die. It's not just a metaphor. It is actually a spirit. spiritual reality when you're baptized, that you die with Christ and you live with Christ. The power of resurrection that rose Jesus from the dead lives in you too now. Amen? And that was what we learned about the baptism of water. And also last week, Pastor Chris dropped the bomb on us, right? He talked about how every single believer who is seriously following Jesus, you think you're being led to walk in the park? It ain't so, my friends. Those of you who follow Jesus, the Spirit of God will lead you into the wilderness. Nobody wants to preach this kind of messages because it don't feel so good. But sometimes it's a thing that doesn't feel so good is actually good for you. Is that right? Listen, I just took my boy to the dentist this week. He had a little cavity inside of him. There's a little hole in his teeth. And I just remember he was telling me, Daddy, where are we going today? Why are you picking me up so early? I took him out early from school. He was so excited until I dropped the D word. It ain't doomsday. It's dentist day. And he was like, dentist? Why? What? I repent. I remember I took my boy and it's like, boy, hey, listen, it's worth it. Do you trust me? I trust you, but I don't trust the dentist. Why you gotta take me there? Can you do it yourself? I can, but no. So, you end up with more damage than good, boy. Come with me. And we went to the dentist's office. We sat down. And he was prepared. You could tell he was preparing himself mentally. I swear, man, he almost looked like he was about to speak in tongues. I mean, he was so in so much pressure, my boy. He was like, Daddy, I don't want to do this. Daddy, do you love me? I love you, boy. Then get me out of here. But I had to look at him and tell him, boy, it's good for you. But it don't feel so good. I know, but it's good for you. And I remember we came into the dentist. We were in the waiting room and he was already done. He was like, gotta take my mind off watching the cartoons. Even the cartoons couldn't help. He's like, why do they look like they're screaming in pain? Now he's seeing it everywhere. And we walk into the chair. There was the chair, right? It was the wilderness for him. And he saw the chair. He sat down. And I remember, I just looked at him, boy, I'm right here with you. Look at me, I'm right here with you. I'm not gonna leave you. I'm right here with you. He goes, okay. And he put on the gas. My boy was feeling a little loopy at that moment. You know, because he was in a place many times before the surgery, before the procedure can happen. You know, he had to go through a phase where he had to clear himself. But in that moment, there was so much worry, there was so much anxiety. And I remember the dentist sat down, you ready? And you know, he just opened his mouth and he began to go, ow, 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 it hurts. He just opened his mouth. And the first thing he shouted, Daddy, where you at, Daddy? Where are you at? I go, I'm right here, but you don't need to shout. I'm right here. But many times in that season, when you're on that chair, you feel so alone. You feel like no one is present. In that procedure that took place, many times you feel numb. You feel like you can't feel yourself. You feel like you're not yourself. Because then they shot the, what you want to call it, the anesthetic, you know, to numb his face. And he start like just drooling. Hey, I don't like this. You know, he can't feel his face. He starts to shake himself. He goes, hey, don't put your hand down. And he went through the process. And as he went through the process, my heart breaks. Because he reached out like it was an old pop concert. And he was reaching out like, help me. But I had to allow him to go through it. Because if you are a good, good father, you will allow your children to go through process no matter how painful it is. And a lot of times the child going through the process does not feel the love. But how many of you know that chair is good for him? And he came out, even though he felt a little loopy, but afterward he goes, hey, I don't feel pain when I eat. Exactly. It's good for you. A lot of you have holes in your soul. And you are now being led to the wilderness. You're going, why, God, if you love me, why you lead me here? But do you know that it is for your good that he leads you to the wilderness? Because in the wilderness, it is, let me just tell you this, in the wilderness is not a place of destruction. It is an opportunity for construction. That's what God wants to do in your life. Tell your neighbors, hey, he's not going to destroy you. Tell your neighbor, he's not going to destroy you. Amen? But tell him, he's going to build you. So tell him this, so let him. Don't fight it. The more you fight it, the longer it becomes. You know, we were supposed to be in a dentist only for 20, 30 minutes. We end up staying there for almost an hour because he fought it. So quit fighting God. It does no good for you. Quit fighting God. So I got a sermon just from watching my son in the dentist. It was awesome. So here's what I want to bring you to. We talked about the wilderness, but here's the count that I want to bring us to this week. So what happened after he got out of the wilderness? See, maybe when you're in the wilderness, you can't see the end of it, but you have to know there is the end of the wilderness. A lot of you feel like you're going through the valley of the shadow of death. The Bible never says you're going to stay in the valley of the shadow of death. The promise is you will go through the valley of the shadow of death. And your shepherd will be right there with you. He walks you through it. He did not call you to stay somewhere. He called you to walk through it. Amen? And so after the wilderness season, that's what we're going to focus on today. We've been focusing on the book of Matthew. And the main passage we're going to be using today is Matthew chapter 14, verse 12 to 22. And we're going to do a little parallel study with Luke 4 to 14 until Luke 5 to 11. I'm not going to read it all, obviously. We're just going to pick up a couple of things. And we're going to see what happens. Because in the book of Matthew, not many things are told. So the book of Luke completes that. And so we want to see what happened in between. The book of Matthew is very, very powerful. Because this book of Matthew is all about seeing Jesus as king. And the coming of his kingdom. And the fact that his kingdom is present. And when his kingdom is present, he begins to change the atmosphere around him. And so that's what we want to look at today. So Matthew chapter 4, verse 14 and 15. So then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee. This is Luke. And news of him went through all the surrounding region. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. After the wilderness season, when Jesus returned from the wilderness season, he returned in the power of the Spirit. The only reason why God leads you to the wilderness is so that you can walk back, when you can walk away from it, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. There is no means to destroy you, but his means is to construct you, is to build you up, so that when you walk away, maybe you fall before, but by the time you walk away from it now, you're going to be stronger than before. And sometimes he has to work you out a little bit, because we are spiritually obese. And he walks us to the wilderness to begin to process out, to begin to trim away a lot of excess things that we don't really need. And when you walk away, man, Jesus walked away lean. You know what I'm saying? Spiritually, he walked away all decked out, six pack. The whole thing, man. He was packed out. He was in power. A lot of us don't look like that spiritually. A lot of us don't look like that physically. Conviction begins to hit. I repent, Lord. But you return, you come out of the wilderness in power of the Holy Spirit to do what? Here's what happens next. And news of him went out throughout all the surrounding region. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. So in Matthew chapter 4, however, it puts it like this. Now when Jesus heard, so this is right after the baptism and into the wilderness. Now when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he departed to Galilee. That was the missing piece there that was spoken in Luke, but not spoken in the book of Matthew. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea, in the regions of Zebulun and Naphtali. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The first headquarters that Jesus began to build is not just among the Jews, but among the Gentiles, because God's heart has always been for those who are outcasts. And he had to go there. He had to be there in the Galilee of the Gentiles, because the call of God is for all nations. Amen. And so he went over there, and what begins to happen? It fulfills the prophecy in the book of Isaiah that says, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. Why? Because the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of light, the king has come, the champion is here. And so people have seen a great light, and upon those who sat in the region and the shadow of death, light has dawned. Some of you have come here today, you've been sitting in the dark for way too long. You've been sitting in depression for way too long. You've been sitting in your addiction for way too long. You've been sitting in your hopelessness for way too long. You've been sitting on dead relationships for way too long. You've been sitting in bondages for way too long. But I want to tell you today, the king is here. The champ is here. The light is here. Those who are in darkness will now see the light. Will now see the light. Are you ready to see the light? From that time, Jesus began to preach to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's what I want to talk about today. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I talked a little bit about it when I was preaching about John the Baptist. Now, this is echoed again in Jesus, and it carries a lot more weight. Before, it came from the messenger of the kingdom, but now it comes from the king himself. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. When John the Baptist was speaking it, the king was still coming, but by the time Jesus spoke it, the king is here. And it carries a different weight. It carries a different meaning when it comes from the king. It comes from the mouth of the king himself. He says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Have any of you ever wondered what that means? Like, what is this gospel that he's preaching? The gospel of the kingdom. Because if we don't understand the gospel of the kingdom, a lot of us will be driven by other gospels. In America, many of us are driven by the gospel of prosperity. If you accept Jesus, everything is going to be all good. It's going to be a walk in the park. God's going to remove all your problems. But how many of you that is present here today, the day that you met Jesus, it feels like your world has done fall apart. But it's not falling apart. It's falling into place. It's falling into place. God sometimes had to tear stuff up in order for him to build the right things. That's in the season of our lives. Have you ever wondered why people preach that? Because it's a feel-good message. When you come to our church, sometimes people go, man, why do you got to speak stuff that hurts? Because it's good for you. Amen? We need to be challenged outside of the comfort zone. You know, I come from Indonesia, and when our mother church, Abba Love, comes from Indonesia, it is one of the most persecuted countries in the world, where many Christians are killed, churches are burned down. But let me tell you, one of our senior pastor, our elder, if you will, that's speaking to me and Chris, his dad, Mufasa, Leo Senior, was speaking, and he said, you know, Mike, you guys have it harder here in the States. And I was like, wait. But you have the ISIS. But you have the jihadi. You go, yeah, but they drove us closer to Jesus. What? Yeah, they drove us closer to Jesus. But what you have here is not Osama bin Laden, but Osama bin Comfort. Osama bin Comfort. It disables you from believing that Christ is Lord, and he wants to drive you, that he's not calling a bunch of weak Christians that walk without power, but he's raising up an army. That's what you're called to. You're not called to be sitting in a kumbaya group. You're called to be in the army of the living God, that every area of your life falls in line with your commander chief. And God is about to produce a faith in you today if you allow him to produce a faith in you, to begin to look at your life a little differently. To begin, instead of having comfort persecute you, it's about time you persecute comfort a little bit. Don't let the devil rob you blind. Or sometimes we hear the gospel in America preaching the gospel of salvation. What does that mean? When you die, you go to heaven if you accept Jesus. Hell, heaven. Hell, heaven. Which one do you pick? Sign me up for heaven. So people's mindset is about being a Christian. It's about going to. But here's the problem. Where are you living now? on earth. The purpose of God was never meant to bring you to heaven. That's not what you read. The purpose of God was never to bring you to heaven, but to bring heaven here on earth. That has always been the purpose of God. He did not come to bring you into heaven. He has come to call you to bring heaven down. You are the franchise of heaven that he wants to establish here on earth. That everywhere you go, heaven is released. Healing is released. Deliverance is released. That's what God wants to do through your life. Marriages will be restored. Death will rise. The blind will see. The lame will walk. That's what God wants to do through your life. The kingdom wants to be manifested through your life. That's always been it. But if we preach the gospel of salvation, hallelujah, I am now saved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then you go home, beat your wife, beat your kids. Useless. Useless. Because Christ is not king. Every week you come just talking about your own problems, but you don't see the people dying around you. Your heart becomes cold and numb, and you mind your own business, and that's about it. You're not about your father's business, but you're about your own business. If you're not about your father's business, then you're about the other father's business, the father of lies. Don't be trapped. Don't be trapped. There's a call for repentance today. When I looked at my own life, I see that even I, who serve God many times, fall into that same spot. My brothers, my sisters, I love you. We need to repent today from this. We need to repent from this. Because if not, he will rob you blind. What is the gospel of the kingdom? Well, Jesus broke it down in the book of Luke. So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. What is it about Isaiah today? Right? Just God raising up Isaiah. All right. And when he had opened the book, he found a place where it was written. Jesus was so swagged out. Let me tell you, that was kingdom swag that he had. He rolled into the temple on Sabbath day, and they handed him a scroll, and I can just imagine in my head, whoosh, and he was looking for a passage, very specific, because remember, his message is very simple. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is here, is at hand. Why? Because the king is here. The king is here, where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me. Let me stop right there. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me. Here's what God is saying. Because when he walked out of the wilderness, he was walking with the power of the Spirit of God without limits. He was able to see into the supernatural. He was able to see the unseen. Do you know there is two different realities? The one that is seen and the one that is unseen. But if you allow yourself to be controlled by the seen, you have no idea, but you've been enslaved by spirits that you don't even know, that you don't even see. Many of your behavior, many of your emotions, many of your thoughts are, that's by the way, the persecution, the demonic persecution and manifestation in America. It's not like in Asia where it's crazy manifestation, but here it hides behind thoughts. Have you ever had suicidal thoughts in your life? Have you ever had hopeless thoughts in your life? Have you ever had such a judgmental thought about yourself, about other people? You have to know that there's something operating behind it. Have you ever had an anger that is uncontrollable? Have you ever suffered those kind of things? Is there any sickness that was passed down from generation to generation in your family? There's many things that is present, but we don't take notice of it. Because here in the West, we think everything needs to be logical. Everything needs to be based on what we see. But the Bible says everything that you see in the book of Hebrews was created based on the things that is unseen. So, you know, the best way for the enemy to attack you is to hit you where you can't see him. And he's been stealing from you. in the cover of darkness behind your mind. He's been robbing you of intimacy in marriage because he keeps on putting judgment towards your husband, towards your wife. He keeps on putting a filter towards your husband, towards your wife, towards your children, about your own mom, about your own dad, and that filter has never been removed, and you keep on projecting it on people. And you are bound by those things. But this is why the gospel of the kingdom is necessary. It is needed because those things enslave you. And the Spirit of God has anointed Jesus, the King. You know what anointing means? To be empowered to. I want you to know that God did not only anoint Jesus, but he also anointed you. Church, the same anointing that is on Jesus, the same Spirit that is on Jesus lives within you too. So this means what? This message applies to all of us. Amen? Here's what he says. What was he anointed to do? To preach the gospel to the poor. To preach the gospel to the poor. Do you know in those times, many different theologians look at this many different ways. This is talking about the spiritually bankrupt, but actually in the book of Luke, this is talking about literally people who are poor. About people who are poor, because in those days, if you are poor, if you are in poverty, then it is considered that God is angry with you, that you have been cursed. That poverty was a sign that you are hated by God. That you are hated by God. That was the teaching that was going around in that time. And as a matter of fact, that demonic teaching is still present today. It is not about the poorness itself. But do you know that all of you here in America, we also have poverty mindset? How many of you here are being chased by worry every single month? Some of you are being chased by worry every single week. Some of you are being chased by worry every single day. Afraid of the phone, the bill collector calling you. 800 number, block. You know what that's going to be about. Running. You have a poverty mindset. You're always in lack. You're emotionally bankrupt. You're constantly depending on another person to fulfill you emotionally. That's why you move from relationship to relationship. You are poor. You are bankrupt. How many of you are controlled by the mindset of lack? That you're always lacking something. You know why it's called the good news? The good news was given because it's actually good news. There's no trick. There's no hidden meaning behind it. It means good news. The king comes and he says this. If you repent and you make me king, that will no longer occupy you. That will no longer be your king. Lack will no longer be your king, but he will be your king. Repent. Make Jesus Lord in this area of your life. Make him king. Quit chasing after stuff that's not going to satisfy you. Make him king. And when you have the kingdom, everything fades away. Everything fades away. If you are chased by the desire for success, today God is saying, lay that down. Chase after me. Make him famous, not make you famous. Because you were always meant to be his reflection. Amen. You were called to make him famous. That's the call in your life. So to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. Who are the brokenhearted? These are those of you who have relationship problems. You know, in order for you to be brokenhearted, you need to come close enough to a person to get hurt. And usually it's the people that knows us very well. It's usually the people who are closest to us that hurts us the most. Is that right? Some of you here have experienced some brokenheartedness, and it comes from your family. And it comes from previous relationships. It comes from your parents. It comes from a husband, a wife. That is the first level. Maybe it's a sibling. Maybe it's a cousin. Maybe it's an uncle. Maybe it's a grandpa or grandma. No matter who it is, you've received hurt in your life, and you are brokenhearted. Maybe there was some broken promises spoken into you. You ever experienced that before? There's some broken promises spoken in your life, and you are brokenhearted. You are in mourning. A lot of you here are in a phase of mourning. You have lost something very precious to you. Maybe it's a friendship. Maybe it's a relationship. But you have lost something in your life. Maybe it's your integrity that you've lost. Maybe it's your character that you've lost. Maybe it's a commitment that you've lost. Something that you have lost, and you are in mourning. You are brokenhearted. And God wants to let you know that He has been sent to heal the brokenhearted. If you have relationship problems, what He wants to do is to first reconcile you to Him. That He is king in this area of relationship. Is He king in the area of your relationship? Those of you who are single, those of you who are crying out to God, God, send me the one. You sing songs like, Jesus, I am thirsty. Won't you come and fill me? And then, 3 years later, you sing a different song. Jesus, I am 30. You know, when Adam got Eve, Adam was asleep. He was not worried about Eve, but God knew who He needed. When you keep on trying to wake up looking for someone, He ain't gonna give it to you. You're not gonna be appreciative anyways when you get it. But because Adam was so focused on the mission of God, and when he awoke into it, he says, whoa, man. When Adam was alone, God gave him charge over Eden. But when God brought Eve along, God gave him charge over the entire earth. The anointing grows when God brings someone into your life. But it doesn't have to be that special someone. Do you want to know that you need community in your life? That's the point. Some of you here needs to learn to be plugged into a small group. If you can't deal with your small group, you can't deal with no relationship. Because in your small group, you learn to be open. You learn to take off your mask. Amen? God wants to heal you in your small groups. You know when you first enter into a small group, our cell group, because that's what we believe church is. This is not church. This is celebration. This is a gathering of the churches. We believe that church is a place where you practice one another, where you can be transparent, where you can be real. And a lot of us like to put on masks. When we come into a community, you want to put your best face. Your poker face. You want to look good. You want to look like you got no problems. You come in and you look at everyone. And everyone look at you. And you smile. And you go, everybody looks like angels. 3 months later, you look at everyone. You say, get behind me, Satan. But if you don't learn to live in community, because that is God's training gun for a relationship, you won't do very well even in your own relationship. So singles, tell your neighbor, it's good to be single. Thank you, Jesus. Send her that one. Let Him heal your broken heart. Because when you're brokenhearted, you're constantly looking for somebody to fill it. You're not, I've always said this before, I'm going to say it again. You are not half a person looking for your other half. You are not half and half. You are not fried rice looking for chow mein. That's not who you are. Throw you a panda joke there. Panda. Okay. Because if you are a half looking for a half, you will always constantly demand and expect. God wants you to be a whole person looking for another whole. Amen? So tell your neighbors, I am a whole person. Tell your neighbors, I don't need nobody to validate me. Say, validation comes from the Lord. And all the singles say. Don't say that. Don't say that. He's going to hold you to it. Don't say that. I repent. Those, I can see the married folks. Lord, I repent. Oh, God, this creature you have given me. This creature, wow. Make Jesus king in this area. So for a man, he will teach you to become a real man. Because in the Bible, the definition of a man is not your genitals. Being a male is a matter of choice. Being a man, being a male is a matter of birth, but being a man is a matter of choice. God and women is looking for some real men. Here's a standard. You ready? Manhood and Christ-likeness are synonymous. To be a man is to be like Christ. That's a man. See, only the ladies clap. No, none of the men clap. Yeah. Repent! And ladies, God is creating a virtuous woman inside of you. That you are beautiful, not because of the stuff you put on, but the stuff that he built inside of you. You don't need to compare yourself to the magazine. You don't need to compare yourself to your neighbors, because you are created in God's image. For you to insult the product is for you to insult the manufacturer. For you to say that you're defective, you're blaming the manufacturer. And let me tell you, this manufacturer is perfect. Ladies, you are perfect just the way you are. Don't make me go Bruno Mars on you. Repent. Let him heal your brokenheartedness. So when you enter into relationship, you're not going to carry your baggages. You're not going to carry your baggages, which brings me to the next one. To proclaim liberty to the captives. Many of you, because of your brokenheartedness, you have allowed yourself to be open to other spirits. Okay. Believe it or not, there is an unseen. And there, if there is a God, then there are also the opposite of God, the enemy of God. These are demons, the devil, Satan, and his minions. I'm not talking about the minions like the movie. I'm talking about like real minions. Right? The one that operates behind people's emotions, that bound people to certain thoughts. You know, many of us, there's many times with me and my wife even, where we are building a relationship with one another, there are things that comes out of me that I could not control, it feels like. I remember, this was a recent conflict. Can I share with y'all? You mind? You know, your pastor is still learning. Okay? Okay, remember church, in our here's the motto in our church. You ready? Openness. Say that again. Openness is the key to healing. Openness is the key to healing. I want you to tell three people around you, openness is the key to healing. Openness is the key to healing. That's what it says in James 5:16. The least practiced passage in the whole Bible. Confess your sins one to another so that you will be healed. If you want forgiveness, you practice 1 John 1:9. Confess your sin to God, he forgives you. But if you want healing, you need to confess your sins to one another. That's when healing comes. That's when healing comes. I remember we had a conflict and the conflict was no big deal. I just didn't listen very well. I'm the preacher, go figure. And so, my wife was trying to unveil something from inside of her heart. And she goes, and she even gave me a forewarning. Did I say he or she? Okay, she gave me a forewarning. Hey, listen, these are just the lies that I bought into. Don't take it personally. I was like, oh, no, I'm not going to take it personally. I got this. Go ahead. Go ahead, share.
Healing.
Okay, so she began to share. I feel like you don't care for me. And immediately I went from. And then. Okay. I understand. No, I don't understand inside. When she was expressing all these things to me, I feel like this. This is just my feeling. It's not right. But I feel like she was confessing her sin. But when she was confessing her sin, because I have something inside of me, I have a fear of judgment. See, I have a fear of judgment. You know, what was being communicated to me is like, honey, I feel like, even though this is a lie, I feel like you don't care about me. In my head, you know what I hear? You're a terrible husband. You're a terrible husband. Why you call yourself a man of God? You can't even take care of your wife. Hypocrite. How many of you one day, see, they got really silent in this room. You know why? Because a lot of you have those kind of thoughts. These are demonic spirits that speaks because I have come to an agreement with a lie. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. When you were baptized, you died with Christ and you raise again with Christ to a new life, but yet you still carry your old man on your back. It's time to put him down because we don't need any more Resident Evil in our lives. And I mean that in every way. It's too many Resident Evil. We don't need any more of that in our lives. Would you finally bury the old man? I'm not talking about your daddy. I'm talking about the old self, the old identity that you believed in. And me and my wife, caught it in that moment. She goes, that ain't you, honey. And then I came to an awareness, you're right. Why did I think like that? Why was I feeling that way? When she called it out, immediately it let go. This is what Jesus wants to do in your life. He wants to remove those junk from your life. Listen, when you have a scrape or a scratch on your hand, like a cut, what begins to happen if you don't take care of it? Infection by what? Bacterias, right? You have bacterias. But when you have a cut in your soul and you don't take care of it, what will you have? An infection. But what does the bacteria look like? These are demonic spirits that begins to hover over that area because you have not allowed healing to happen there. And you are bound and you don't even know it. These are spiritual terrorists that comes into your life robbing you blind. You don't even know it. And when you begin to address it, Christians, this is why we fear discipleship. It's not you who fear it, but something inside of you is aggravated when you hear discipleship, when you hear about openness, when you hear about coming into the light. Why? Because it does not want to leave you. It wants to stay and bound you, but it is a lying spirit. And you have no place of that in your life because God has anointed you. By the Spirit of God, He has anointed you to preach the gospel to the poor. But how do you do that if you have a poverty mindset? He has called you to heal the brokenhearted. But how do you do that if you continue to hold on to your broken heart? He has called you to proclaim liberty to the captives. But how do you do that if you yourself is in captivity? Repent. Turn to the King. Those of you who are in a relationship and you've been living an unholy life, repent. Turn to the King. Don't let the enemy bound you any longer. Turn to Him. Those of you who have been judging your husband, your wife, repent. God has given to you and God has given her to you. Even though sometimes you feel like she or he comes from hell. It's not true. It's a lie from a pit of hell. Amen? And recovery, sight of the blind. What is this? Those of you who have no vision in your life today, God wants to restore vision in your life. Those of you who don't know where you're going in life and you just kind of living mundane, continuing to live day to day, God wants to heal you from your blindness. Return and repent to the King, and He wants to recover your blindness. He wants to restore your blindness. He wants to heal you from your physical disease, from your emotional disease, and from your mental disease, and especially your spiritual diseases. Let Him heal you. Set at liberty those who are oppressed. These are people who are held down by very specific thoughts. Some of you here, I want to just spend a little time here. Some of you here have inner vows. Do you know what that is? What are inner vows? You spoke this into yourself when you went through a trauma in your life. Let's say your parents went through a divorce. Have any of you ever said this? I will never become like them. You made an inner vow. Have you ever made that before? But then you find yourself being more and more like them. Anybody? Some of you say, I will never be good enough. You speak this to yourself. And then no matter how talented you are, no matter how many people tell you, you can't believe it. You have made an inner vow. Some of you cursed the day you were born. And that's why you're followed around by the spirit of death. You have suicidal thought consumes you. Depression consumes you. Because you made an inner vow. God wants to set you free, those of you who are oppressed. There are some of you who have bitter root judgments. You have been hurt and you judged somebody in your life and you made it in your... And no matter how good that person gets, they're never good enough. Because you have a bitter root judgment in your heart. You are oppressed. Some of you have death wishes. Some of you have soul ties. Some of you have entered into a relationship with somebody that you know you ought not enter into a relationship with. And now you carry their stuff too. You have a soul tie. Some of you have word curses. We've experienced this before, even in our church with one of our members when this person went through a season of depression and they cursed themselves. And they cursed themselves. And when they cursed themselves, whatever they spoke stuck into them, hold on to them. And they can't break free. Maybe some of you here have ungodly burdens or secrecy. This is for those of you who have been abused sexually. Let me speak into you. Listen, I've been sexually abused too. And one of the words that was spoken, I remember by my cousin, my guy cousin who sexually molested me. If you tell anyone, he threatened me, I'm going to kill you. If you tell anyone, you're going to destroy the family. That is a burden of secrecy. Some of you have been carrying this weight. God wants to set you free from it if you allow Him. If you allow Him, let Him set you free. Do you want freedom today? Amen? Because He has come here to set you free. Repent, turn to Him. And lastly, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. I want to let you know that this is your year. Maybe you've been hitting a wall before, but I'm letting you know that this is the year where the wall comes down. Amen? Turn to the King. Repent. Make Him Lord. You will see those things that were in your obstacle, doors that are closed to you before will now be open. Will you allow Him to process you this year? And right after that, Jesus found the first disciple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew. And He calls them to follow Me, and I will make you a fisher of men. What does it mean to be a fisher of men? To do the things that Jesus does. That God has called you to proclaim the gospel to the poor. He has sent you to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. But it begins today by you making Him your Lord. Will you stand with me? Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Even as I was speaking these things, God begins to remind you of some things in your life. Some of you who have been in lack and you consistently being chased by this thought that you're always lacking, that you're always not going to have enough. Whether it is emotionally, financially, or whatever, you have not yielded this area of your life to the King. But today, will you surrender your worry? Will you lay this down? Will you submit to Him as King? Will you submit to Him as King? and let him show you the kingdom of heaven, something of greater worth than what you're chasing. If you are in lack, today, repent, come to the King. Tell him, Lord, I lay this down before you. I'm no longer going to chase after success. I'm no longer going to chase after the money, God. I'm going to work hard. I'm going to do what you want me to do. I'm going to chase after the dream that you have given me, because it's not just my dream, it's kingdom dream. God, I want that for my life. Those of you who have poverty mindset, make a declaration today that you will submit to the King. If that's you, I want to come in agreement with you. Let's go through it one by one. I want to come in agreement with you. There's power in agreement. Amen? But you have to do it boldly. If there's an agitation inside of you, you have to learn to say and rebuke that and go, in Jesus' name, be obedient to Christ. Those of you who are consumed by worry about your future, about your tomorrow, today come to repentance. Will you lay your hand on your chest? That will be your agreement with me. I see you. Okay, I see you. I see you. I see you. All right. All right. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's come into repentance together. We have given ourselves to other gods, to money, to worry about the future. It consumes you. It keeps you up at night. It keeps you up. God says, I want to give you rest. I want to show you something worth living for. Thank you, Lord. Let's come before him. Would you say this? Lord, I repent. Come on. Lord, I repent for making lack my focus, that I never have enough. I have a poverty mindset. God, I repent. I turn to the King. Jesus, you are my Lord. I surrender this area into you. You are my Lord. You are the one who provides for me. You are a good, good Father who will never forsake me. You are a good, good Father who provides for me. I have all that I need in you. I repent. We cast out every poverty spirit that has occupied our lives, that has occupied my family. We break your power in the name of Jesus. We cast you out in Jesus' name. You have no more room in my life. Jesus is my Lord. You are not. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Woo, feel that freedom release in this room. For those of you who have relationship problem, you've been brokenhearted by family members who betrayed you. A dad who left you. Those who abuse you in your family. And you have come to an agreement with a lie that you will never be good enough. I want to pray for you. Lay a hand on your chest if that's you. You have broken relationship, and the proof of it is when you get into a relationship now, you keep on getting brokenhearted. Because you are a half still looking for a half. Repent. Surrender this to Jesus. Make him Lord in this area of your life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I see you. I see you. I see you all across the room. Those of you who have bitterness against somebody, who have judgments against somebody, repent today. Repent today. Repent today. Repent today. Make him Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Say, Lord Jesus, I repent for making other people, for making relationship God over my life. I seek out relationships to fulfill me, but it can never fulfill me. Only you can fulfill me. I repent today for idol worship. I worship sex. I worship relationship. I repent today. I turn away from that. Only you can satisfy me.
The God who calls me is holy. He is whole. Therefore, I am holy. I am made whole. Only through Christ. In Jesus' name, we cast out every lustful spirit. Every idolatry spirit. We command you, come out in Jesus' name. You have no more place. Set people free in this room today, God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Those of you who are bound by pornography, you are bound by addictions. Maybe it's substance abuse. You are addicted to all kinds of things. You are addicted to negative thoughts. You have suicidal thoughts inside of you. Bring it before God. Bring it before God. Bring it before God. If that's you, lay your hand. I see you. I see you. I see you. I see you. Okay. I see you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Woo. Thank you, Jesus. Say, Lord, I repent for giving myself to other things other than you. I repent, God, for the abuse in my life. God, I repent over sexual sins. God, I repent over substance abuse. God, I repent over negative thought that I have over myself, that I have over other people, that are lies from the pit of hell. God, I repent from judgment. God, I repent from bitterness. God, I repent from unforgiveness. God, I repent from witchcraft. God, I repent from all these things. I turn to you. You are my Lord. You are my King. You are the only one who can save me. Free me, God. Once and for all, plant me in a community that helps in my healing process. I no longer want to be bound by these things. I serve only one master. I serve Jesus. I worship Jesus and only Him. God, right now, we cast out every spirit that is not of you in the name of Jesus. Come out of my life. You have no place in Jesus' name. Break free. Woo! Freedom, God. Freedom, God. Freedom, God. Freedom, God. In Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord. This is the year that you will accept that God says this is the year of liberty for you. Those of you who have believed that life will never change and you will always be where you are stuck, you need to repent from those thoughts. You need to repent from hopelessness. Those of you who have been feeling hopeless, it's like you're trapped in your situation. We want to come in agreement with you. We want to pray with you. Will you lay hand on your chest? If that's you, you feel like you're stuck in a season. Like this year is just going to be exactly the same. You have bought into a lie. You have bought into a lie. I see you. I see you all across the room. I see you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Say this, Lord, enough is enough. I'm done with believing in a lie, being enslaved by situation. I no longer bow down to these things. I repent for believing in a lie more than the truth of what you say for my life. God, today I forsake those lies. I cancel those lies. I believe in what you say, that my tomorrow is found in you. And this year will be the year of Jubilee. It is a year of freedom. It is a year of breakthrough. It is a year of healing. This is the year that you sent me out into the field, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing the broken heart, proclaiming liberty to those who are in captivity, to restore sight of the blind, to proclaim liberty to the oppressed, and to declare the year of Jubilee is at hand. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Woo! Now we're going to continue to pray for one another even after we close, but I want to close first. How many of you felt that lift from your life? Okay, but listen, it's not enough that you just make this proclamation. You need those who will walk with you now. If you are not in a small group community, I challenge you today. This is your means of repentance and coming to the Lord. Join a small group. Come talk with me or Pastor Chris or my wife or any of the core leaders, Pastor Eric. You can talk to any of us and we'll point you towards the right direction. You need a community around you. You're called not to be a Rambo Christian. Rambo is Hollywood. Rambo comes into the jungle with a bow and arrow and everybody else has semi-automatic weapons and he kills them all in one shot. That is Hollywood. It's not real. You're called to be in a squad. You're called to be in a team. You are called to be in a group that will charge the gates of hell and it shall not prevail against you. You're called to be in the church. The church is the small group. Join one. Be in discipleship. That's your challenge today. Don't just make these proclamations and not do anything after. Let's do something together. Amen? Amen? Let's experience it this year. Would you lay hand on somebody right next to you? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for brothers and sisters, family, in the same team. God, we speak blessings over them. We believe, Father God, that you will do even greater works. That, Father God, you have, the same way you have anointed Jesus, now Jesus is our King. He has anointed us with the same anointing. The Spirit of God is upon me. And he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Whew. To heal the brokenhearted. To proclaim liberty to the captives. To restore the sight to the blind. To proclaim liberty to the oppressed. To declare the year of Jubilee is here. God, that's what you have anointed us for. That's what it means to follow you and to be a fisher of men. God, we are doing these things. God, we submit to it. And we turn to you. We love you, Lord. We bless you. We bless one another. Walk with us. Show us, Lord, what it means to be a disciple. We love you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. And all that believe say, amen and amen and amen. Praise God.